Hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand praise. Give the Lord a hand praise. Amen. I didn't say Obama. I didn't say Magic Johnson. I didn't say the Lakers, but give the Lord a hand praise. Amen. He deserves all the praise. Amen. We would like to thank you to Triumphant Ministries International, our apostle, Michael Hodges, in his absence. We give honor to him. Amen. And we thank you for coming this morning and visiting us. Amen. Hallelujah. I'm going to begin with prayer. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you. We give you glory. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise, O God. We honor you today, O God. We magnify your name, O God. We thank you for who you are in our lives, O God. We magnify your name, O God. You're so worthy to be praised, O God. Oh, di arara shandere kendi araranda. Shakuya tandi ararande ke. We glorify you, Lord. We magnify your name, Lord, for who you are, Lord God. We thank you that this is the day that you have made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, O God. We thank you that you woke us up this morning, O God. We thank you, Lord God, that you have already provided us, oh God. You have provided for us every need, Lord God. We thank you that by your stripes we are healed, we are whole, we are delivered, we are set free by the blood of Jesus, Lord. We thank you for the blood of Jesus that heals us, that delivers us, that covers us, that protects us, oh God. We glorify your name, Lord, that you died on the cross, oh God. We thank you, Lord God. We glorify you, Lord, that you rose from the grave, Lord. For every sin, for every iniquity, for every sickness and disease, Lord God, we thank you. We are so grateful this morning, oh God. We thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. We glorify your name, oh God. Touch every family that is represented, oh God. Touch everyone that walks through the door, oh God. Even those that aren't here, Father God, touch them, Lord God. Touch April and her family, oh God. Felicia and her family. Touch Leotis, Lord God. Touch Crystal, Lord God. Touch their families, oh God. Touch those that are on their way, oh God. In the name of Jesus. We don't know what people are going through, Lord, but we know that you sit high and you look low, Lord God. And we pray against depression, Lord God. We pray against sadness, Lord God, during this season, Lord God. Those that don't know what to do, Lord God, and they have things going on in their minds, Lord, and they're feeling discouraged, we thank you that you touch them right now, God, in the name of Jesus. Those that want to give up, those that want to throw in the towel, Lord God, we thank you that you touch them this morning, oh God, that they cry out to you, Lord. You told us to cast every care because you care for us, oh God. Allow them to cast every care on the altar today, Lord God. We pray that everyone in here will cast every care, Lord. We thank you that you will rain down on us today, Lord God. Send your fire from heaven, oh God, to touch everyone under the sound of my voice, Father. Touch, Lord God, the woman of God that's going to bring forth the word. Cover her, Lord God, with the blood of Jesus, Lord God. Allow her to bring the word with fire, oh God. We know that it's already inside of her belly, and it will come forth as pure gold. We thank you, Lord God. We glorify your name, oh God. We magnify you, Lord, because you are worthy. Hallelujah. You are worthy, Lord. We are thankful, God. We are thankful that we have a place to stay, Lord. Many are homeless right now, Lord. Many don't have food to eat, Lord God. But we thank you that you have already provided for us, God, even financially, with jobs and vehicles if we need it, oh God. We thank you, Lord. You told us to speak to the mountain. Be thou removed and cast into the sea. We speak to every situation right now in the name of Jesus, in our families, with our children, in our marriages, our finances, in every area right now. And we cancel the assignment of the enemy in the name of Jesus, Lord. We thank you that no weapon formed against us shall prosper right now in the name of Jesus. Cover our apostle as he is out today, Lord God, wherever he may be, Lord. Touch him. Be with him. Minister to his every need, oh God. We give you glory, honor, and praise for those in TMI. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen. Hallelujah. We glorify you, Lord. We thank you. And we welcome those that are online, that are watching. We thank you for tuning in today with us. Hallelujah. We are so grateful for this day. We are grateful that we are in the house of God. Amen. In some countries, they can't even say Jesus. In some countries, they will be jailed for reading the word of God. So we are grateful that we can come into the house freely to worship him, to fellowship. Amen. He says when two or more are gathered, he is in the midst. So he is here today. Don't look at the empty chairs because the angels are here. Hallelujah. And we're here. There are many people that should be here, but God will honor those who come into his presence. Amen. And we are so grateful today for to be here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can we have the announcements? Hallelujah.
Good morning, saints. The announcements today are as follows. The announcements today are as follows. We were supposed to have a 24-hour of prayer this past Thursday, but it's been moved to the 27th of December, starting at 6 a.m. And then the $1,000 pledges that were made are due by March 2023. And on December 31st, Sing O Barren will be the theme. Everyone invite a guest. The services will be from 9 p.m. to 12 a.m. Oh, 12:30 a.m. And we need three volunteers to sing. If nobody volunteers, Apostle will be choosing. A board meeting on this Tuesday. It will be an extended meeting from 7 p.m. 10 p.m. God bless you.
Amen, Elder Lana. Thank you so much for our announcements. Hallelujah. Now we're going to have testimony service. Does anyone have a testimony of what the Lord has done, the goodness of God, if he's done anything for you? Amen. The word of God says that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and what? The word of our testimony. Amen. Elder Donald.
Last night I was talking to Pastor Paulette about gas money. And between yesterday and today, I had no clue. $50 has been put into our account. And so we got gas money to go to Riverside today and other things that we need. I just want to give God the praise. He is faithful concerning his promises.
And remember what I told you when you told me that? He's going to make a way. Didn't I say that? And he made a way. God will provide if we trust and believe. Amen. Anyone else have a testimony of the goodness of God? Amen.
Good morning, saints of God. First, giving honor to God who is the head of my life, my beautiful wife in the corner, my spiritual father in his absence today, but everybody's coming here, service staff, and all the members in his family, the body of Christ. My testimony is quite simple, actually, as a matter of fact. I lost my job a couple months ago. Actually, I lost both my jobs in a matter of a week a couple months ago. And since then, I haven't had really too much to do as far as household, and, you know, keeping it above water. But my faith has in the Lord, you know, him being able to come through has with him keeping us. He's been somehow, in some way, finding ways to bring in money so we can pay our rent, our bills, and keep food in the house, X, Y, and Z. And I say that because I haven't had a job. My wife is in school, so stressful. I have to overload it with stress. The stress is going to keep up the marriage. side jobs and odd jobs that I pick up, you know, here and there, you know, that wouldn't, those accumulative incomes haven't been able to actually keep ends meeting. But somehow, every couple of days, some random money ends up in either my wife's account or my account. Wherever it comes from, I don't know, but I thank God nonetheless because he's been making it. He's been making a way out of nowhere. I'm telling you, he can't do that if you just give him that trust that he wants from you. Give him that, he'll be able to take care of, take on the rest. He'll take care of everything else that you have needs and wants for. But you have to be able to have enough faith to be able to leave. So he can have the room that he needs to not be in the box to do what he can do. Not just what he wants to do, but what he can do for you.
Amen. That's awesome, Isaac. He's a young husband. They're newlyweds, and he wants to be their provider. Amen. Usually the husband is the priest, the provider, and the king of his home. So he's doing a good job of wanting to take care of his wife and allow her to go to school. That's an awesome thing. Amen.
Well, a few months ago, I was on Facebook, and I saw a random post. Hey, do you know where there's any good churches? I didn't know who it was. I didn't know where they were. And I said, I was starting to read the responses. Oh, yeah, High Desert Christian, and, you know, some Baptist, and some, you know. And I said, well, if you want to see deliverances and miracles and healings and, you know, signs, miracles, and wonders, then come to my church. And so Maria, well, I'm in South Carolina, and I want that. And I said, good, if you want to see the move of God, come to my church. So, a couple months later, we kind of kept in touch. And here she is, from South Carolina. With her two beautiful boys, and her nephew, Andrew. And they came to our Bible. So good, and people are truly seeking Him. They don't want the powerless churches anymore. They want the churches that are flowing in His power, His grace, and His glory. The revival is here, and we're going to see so many signs, miracles, and wonders. And Maria is experiencing that recently at her church, and just desiring it. And God, we're conceived that way. We're conceived with the desire for God and the things of God. And once we get a taste of that, we cannot live without it. We cannot live without it. And the revival is here. It's going to explode. The Shekinah glory is going to drop. The fire is going to come out the roof. And we are going to see God move like never before on this earth. We need to be ready. We need to study ourselves, to show ourselves approved. We need to have a heart for people. We need to have the mind of Christ. That's a tall thing. We can't get the mind of Christ on our own. We have to have the Holy Spirit. So,
thank you for that testimony, Gwen. We're going to move on with the service. Before I go on, I'm going to make this announcement. An apostle is backing this. He stamps it. When whoever is up here preaching has the mic, they have the floor. So no one else is able to pray or prophesy. The person that has the mic is in charge of praying and prophesying. So there is a protocol for the pulpit and the threshing floor. And when we went to school of ministry, they taught us, and then we did hands-on. But Apostle is getting ready to put that in our bylaws, and that is the protocol. So whoever has the mic is the person that prays and prophesies. Unless she gives us orders to help her, then she's the one that conducts the floor, because God is not the author of confusion. We don't want to disrupt the members that are seated as well as those that are being prayed for. Amen. You can do the offering. We're gonna have this is my beautiful friend, and we kept running into each other at all kinds of conferences and church events, and I would see her, and I'd be like, "There you go again. Are you following me?" Because I would see her at every women's conference or revival, or it would be something, huh? And we kept doing that like for 5 or 6 years, and I'm like, "Wow. God must want us to do something." I didn't know what it was, but eventually we connected and she ended up here. And I want to present to you awesome woman of God, a fire friend, prophetess friend, as she comes in her own way.
Hallelujah. Listen to the song, hallelujah.
In obedience. Looking out in the crowd, I see eyes closed, tears falling, hands lifted, people praising and worshiping too. They didn't see me, they only saw you. It felt good, but something was missing. See, I'm empty inside, and I'm wondering why. Will I ever feel what they felt for me? I didn't know the price of yes. What cost me
to listen to the song
so
God bless you guys. Good morning. Good morning. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Hallelujah. God is good. Amen.
He is awesome. So I just want to give God the glory today and the honor for allowing me to even get up here today. And I'll tell you a little testimony before we get started. Amen. So I give honor to the apostle of this house, Apostle Hodges, in his absence. Amen. He's a great man of God, and I'm going to give you a testimony in just a moment. So I just want to thank God for all of you, my friends and family who are watching, my friends and family who will be joining us today. And God bless Pastor Paulette. Like she said, we were going around and around for years. We kept running into each other, and God wanted us to connect, and there's a reason for that. Amen. So I just want to give you a testimony about Apostle. Amen. I was going through a lot in ministry. While you listen to the song, there's a lot of us. I'll give you the words of the song. It's like, do you remember when God told you yes? You will have to go through something when you say yes to God. Amen. And the song was talking about, are you empty inside? Some of us are sitting here empty inside, right? And you think, like, you see people going forth, but you feel empty. For me, I'm gonna give you my testimony. I was sitting in ministry, and I did feel empty inside. I'm like, Lord, why do I feel so empty? But yet I'm anointed, and God is using me still. I'm still praying for people, still people delivered, but I felt empty inside. And the song also said, are you wondering why? Are you broken and bruised and wondering, will God still use you? Amen. The song said, I am in ministry and I am messed up. Lord, I need you to rescue me because I am broken. Things and events happen that cause us to need healing, deliverance, and to be set free that has us bound. Amen. Even we're in ministry, we are messed up. Amen. Some of us, we go through like divorces. We go through adultery. We go through fornication. We go through people hurting us. We go through gossip. We go through backbiting. We just go through a lot of stuff in life. We go through separation, infidelity. We go through sickness and disease. And we're messed up in ministry. You know, we need God. We need the Lord today. And this is not my message today right now, but I just want to address the ones that have been saved, that are in ministry, that are feel broken, that are messed up. You know, I want to say messed up because sometimes we are. Gifts and calling are, you know, you can still, your gifts and calling are without repentance. So meaning you can still move in your gift and calling and still have and repent, right? So no matter what gift you have, it's going to come forth. But you just have to know that if you feel empty inside, you need Jesus today. And I want God to be able to move today, use me as a vessel, amen? And for a testimony, what I was gonna tell you, hallelujah, I'm nervous, God bless you guys. When I came, I felt broken, amen? I was able to, you know, work in ministry, my calling, my gifts were without repentance, and I was still moving, but I felt empty inside, like the song said, because it touched my spirit. And no matter where I went, I kept feeling tired. Like everywhere in ministry, it was always people coming against me. It was always something in ministry that would try to block me. Like, for instance, an example, I would be in a church, and it would be all prophets in the row. I would be right in the middle. Everybody would address all the prophets and skip me and go to the next person. And, you know, that hurt. You know, that really hurt when that happens in ministry. But it's not them. You know, it's just the enemy using them. But I had went through a lot of things, and I went through divorce, and I went through depression. Amen. I had went through depression. Although I had my gifts, my calling, I was anointed, I was still praying for people, I went through depression. I went through depression in ministry, and it was something through that got on me. And it was a spirit that always made me tired. And I, for some reason, I could not get that spirit off. So my testimony is that when I came through these doors with Apostle, I had so many people praying for me, so many anointed women of God praying for me. I was like, every time I saw one, I was like, oh, can you please pray for me? Whatever that was on me did not come off. So when the first day that I walked through the door, Apostle got it off of me. He just spoke a word. He didn't even lay hands on me. He did not touch me. He just spoke a word, and that spirit just lifted off me. And I felt it, and it's been gone ever since. So I just want to thank God for the apostle of this house. He's a man of God. He is powerful in the Lord. So I just want you to appreciate the gift that we have. Amen. Hallelujah. We got to appreciate him. Hallelujah. So let's just still before the Lord. We just need the Lord to move today. Hallelujah. I'm just going to set, I know our sister prayed, but I'm just going to set the atmosphere because I need God to move on me. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, that he can get the glory out of today, that his glory will come down. So just stand on your feet. Let's just begin to worship the Lord. Hallelujah. Just stand to your feet. We need the glory to come in, and it will only come in if we're on one accord and if we're in worship. Hallelujah. So just begin to worship the Lord. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for your presence today, Lord God. Father, we thank you, Lord. We honor you today, Lord God. Father, we you, hallelujah, for coming in this place, Lord God. We could do nothing without you, Lord. We could do nothing, Lord. We're asking that you come in, take over, Lord God. Take control of this atmosphere today. In the mighty name of Jesus, we command everything that's not like God to remove yourself out of this atmosphere right now so the glory of God can move today. In the name of Jesus, you spirit of weariness, we destroy your power right now. In the mighty name of Jesus. Jesus, we begin to speak the fire of God in this place. Fire today. Fire right now. In the mighty name of Jesus. Glory, glory, glory. King of glory, step in. I die to myself, Lord God, that you will move, Lord God, and that you will get the glory, Lord God. Father, we ask that you will use me to your glory, Lord God. Father, we know we can do nothing without you, Lord God. So, Father, I place myself in your hands, Lord God, and I die to my flesh today, Lord God. Father, forgive us for falling short of your glory, Lord God. We begin to plead the blood of Jesus over us, Lord, to wash us clean from all unrighteousness today, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, we plead the blood, the blood, the blood, the blood, the blood, the blood, the blood of Jesus in this atmosphere, the blood to remove everything that's not like you, God. In the mighty name of Jesus, remove yourself right now. In the name of Jesus, we take authority over this atmosphere and we command the glory of God to rain down on us today. In the name of Jesus, glory, 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 glory. We thank you, Jesus. We ask that you have your way, Lord God. Have your way today. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we speak blessings to each and every person that's here, Lord God. Father, you know what they have need of, Lord God. We pray that you meet all of their needs today, Lord God. In the name of Jesus. Father, let them make their request known to you, Lord God, that you can move on them, Lord God, today like never before. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray that your Shekinah glory will come in this place, Lord God, that your healing power will come down in this place, Lord God. Deliverance will be in the house today, Lord God, that those that are bound will be set free today in the mighty name of Jesus. Be set free today in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, and we bless you. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, we just honor you, Lord. You are King of kings and you are Lord of lords, and we magnify you, Lord. There is none greater than you, Lord God. We bless your name. Hallelujah. We give you praise. We give you praise. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. You may be seated. I don't know if you can turn the microphone up a little bit. Hallelujah. I'm just struggling a little bit to speak. Thank you, Jesus. Every time I try to come up, the enemy tries to attack my voice. Amen. But the devil is a liar, and we are not going to give him credit. Every time I was asked to speak, the enemy would try to attack my voice. But he is a liar. He is a liar. I said, no matter what today, I said, if he tries to attack my voice, I'm still going for it, even if I have to whisper it. Amen. I said, I will whisper it. Hallelujah. I will whisper. So back to the people that are walking in ministry, that are doing what God called them to do, but they're not repenting for what they've been through. We all fall short of the glory of God, and I know God will heal us as we go. Amen. As we go forth in ministry, God will heal us. Amen. So continue to do what God has called you to do. Although you feel messed up or maybe something maybe going on, like if you're in ministry, you need to press forward. I allowed the enemy to hold me back, not to let me come forth. You know, the Lord was pushing me, but then I was allowing the enemy to hold me back. So I just want to tell you today, do not let the enemy hold you back. So no matter what you are doing, no matter what you are going through, you press. You need to press in. Press in and walk towards Jesus. Amen. So now we get to the title of the message. The message today that God gave me, the title, it said, be healed, be delivered and be set free. Amen? And God gave me this message, not only that he told me to speak this message, but he had me go through this message. So what I'm about to tell you is stuff that I've been going through. Amen? So stuff that I've been going through in ministry. And, you know, even you know, we go forth in God, you know, things we go through. So he want us to be healed, be delivered, and set free. So we don't know, as we sit on the pews, somebody may be sitting on there looking pretty. You don't know what they're going through. That's why it's good to be able to discern in the spirit. So that's why I thank God for Apostle, that he can discern what you're going through. Amen. Even though you're seated there, maybe you're looking, you know, beautiful and all that, but you may be going through something. Maybe you feel far apart from God. Maybe you don't hear from God today. We just pray that your eyes will open today in the name of Jesus, that you'll be healed from anything that has you bound, any sickness, any disease. We pray that you'll be delivered from anything you may be going through. So like I went through the stage where something was on me and I was tired. No matter what I do, I could take a million vitamins and I was still tired. Whatever that spirit was, it must have got on me when somebody was, probably when I was going through different ministries going around. But whatever it was, it got on me. But the Lord was able to heal, deliver, and set me free. Amen. So I just thank God for freedom. I have not spoken in about 4 years. So you guys, please pray for me as I'm up here. I'm nervous, and I just want God to have his way today. Amen. So be healed. And all everybody that's watching, and I'm speaking to you as well, be healed, be delivered, and set free. Amen. So we're going to go to the book of Matthew for those that say, oh, she didn't open her Bible. My Bible was open. Amen. We're going to the book of Matthew chapter 9. So Matthew chapter 9, verse 20 through 22. And we're going to talk about the woman with the issue of blood. Amen. So we're just going to read the scriptures. And for those scholars, I'm going to go through this, but it's going to be a little repetitive because God wants you to get what he wants you to get today. So I may repeat some things, but he wants to get this in you. Amen. So go to Matthew chapter 9, verse 20 through 22. And you know how they say, you know the story. I remember I was growing up in church. They said, oh, we're talking about the woman of the issue of blood. And they would say, oh, you know the story. And I would be sitting in the back like, no, I don't know the story. Can you tell me the story? You know, people would be, they'll be in the pews laughing, you know. But I'm like, no, I really don't know the story. So, you know, I learned over the years that when we minister to people, some people may not know the story. Because we say the woman of issue of blood, but everybody may not know the story. Everybody may not read their Bible. Everybody, you know, may not even remember what they read. So we're going to go through the story, amen? So we're going to read Matthew chapter 9, verse 20 and 22. It says, and behold, a woman which was diseased with an issue of blood 12 years came behind him and touched the hem of his garment. They're talking about Jesus. So those that you don't know, when they talk about she came from behind him and touched the hem of his garment, she was talking about Jesus. But we're going to go through that, but I just want to tell you some things as I go through. Amen? Amen. So verse 21 says, for she said within herself, if I but touch his garment, I shall be whole. And she said that within herself. So remember that in your mind. She said within herself. Amen. So keep that in the back of your mind as we go. Verse 22 reads, but Jesus turned him about. And when he saw her, he said, daughter, be of good comfort. Thy faith have made thee whole. And the woman was made whole from that hour. Amen. And now I'm going to read another account. This is the account of Mark. So we're going to read that too. I just want you to get different views of the different speakers that spoke about this issue. Amen. So we're going to go to Mark chapter 5. So Mark chapter 5, verse 23 through 34. And it says, and Jesus went with him. And then we're talking about Jairus, as some people say, a ruler of the synagogue saw him and fell to his feet and said, my little daughter lieth at the point of death. So that's when, in the scene, when we're talking about the scene, the woman with issue of blood, this was happening right before she came on the scene. So Jairus came to his feet, and he fell to his feet and asked Jesus to pray for his daughter, which was, you know, lying at the point of death. So, and then it says, I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her. So is that he was asking Jesus to come and lay your hand and lay his hands on her, that she may be healed and she shall live. And much people followed him and thronged him. And throng means pretty much like flock together, like to be present in a great number, just crowded around him. So those of you that don't know what that means. And when we go to verse 25, it says, and a certain woman which had an issue of blood for 12 years. So remember that she had the issue of blood for 12 years. And verse 26, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and was nothing bettered, but rather grew worse. Verse 27, when she had heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment. So that's pretty much the same story from a different view. She came in press behind him and touched his garment. For she said, if I touch but his clothes, I shall be made whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. Verse 30, and Jesus immediately, knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned about. So as he felt the virtue come out, and he turned about in the press and said, who touched my clothes? So just a little visual of it, you know, he was in the crowd, people were crowded around him, and here comes the woman. I could just imagine her. I don't know if she tried to push through the crowd, but I'm going to tell you the story about her so you can understand it. So as she I believe she probably crawled because she was hiding, and pushed through the crowd and touched his garment, amen? She got to touch, you know, the garments, they had the little tassels on them. So we're going to talk about that as well. And she said in herself, you know, she'll be made whole. And straight away the fountain of blood was dried up, as we just said, and she was healed from the plague. So that was considered a plague when we were reading it, verse 30. And Jesus immediately, knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him in the press. So Jesus turned around. He's like, who touched me? Like his disciples was like, all these people around, like everybody's touching you. Like, what are you talking about? You know, and this is my version of the story too as well. So I'm trying to give you a visual of what it could be like, amen? So I'm gonna add my little versions of the story in there. So he's like, who, you know, like everybody's crowd around him. He's like, who touched me? And his disciples like, you know what? There's so many people around. Everybody's touching you. Like, what are you talking about? Like, who touched me? He's like, no, I felt virtue come out of me. So he's like, who touched my clothes? And then verse 31 says, and his disciples said unto him, thou seest the multitude thronging thee. So y'all see the multitude just crowded around you, you know, and sayest thou, who touched me? And verse 32, and he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. It says he looked around about, and it says, but the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell before him and told him the truth. Verse 34, and he said unto her, daughter, thy faith has made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. And then now I'm going to read an account from Luke, so you can see another side of what happened in this issue. Amen. So we're going to go to Luke chapter 7, verse 43 and through 48. So it reads, and a woman having an issue of blood 12 years, which had spent all her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any, verse 44, came behind him and touched the border of his garment, and immediately her issue of blood stopped. And Jesus said, who touched me? When all denied, Peter and they that were with him said, Master, the multitude throng thee and press thee, and sayest thou, who touched me? So verse 46, and Jesus said, somebody had touched me, for I perceive that virtue is gone out of me. 47, and when the woman saw that she was not hid, she came trembling and falling down before him. She declared unto him before all the people for what cause she had touched him, and how she was healed immediately. So she was explaining, like, why she touched me, why she touched Jesus, and all that, and explained and let them know that she was healed. So she was testifying. Verse 48, And he said unto her, daughter, be of good comfort. Thy faith has made thee whole. Go in peace. Hallelujah. So we see the woman with issue of blood. We know that she was bleeding, probably a menstrual cycle for probably about for 12 years. So I'm speaking to men and women, but the women know, like if you're bleeding for 12 years, have a menstrual cycle for 12 years, you can imagine like what she was going through, so having this issue for 12 whole years, amen? She was considered unclean, you know, and I'm pretty sure she probably had pain, because some of us, when we, you know, have go through our cycles, we may have pain, so she probably, I'm pretty sure she's probably been in pain for like 12 years, so you can imagine what she was going through, amen? And she was considered unclean according to the Jewish law. And the meaning of unclean is she was impure, she was dirty, she was filthy. She was constantly bleeding and unclean for 12 whole years. Can you just picture that in your head? Having this sickness, having this infirmity for 12 whole years. And let me tell you about, I want to go over the law. So at the law at that time, so you can understand like what she was going through. So I'm going to talk about the law. So I'm going to read the law. I'm reading a lot of scripture because God wants you to get, you know, what was going on in that day. Amen. So she had this issue of blood. They had laws concerning people with that was menstrual cycle, and also for, it's not just for the, this law wasn't just for women. It was also for men, because there was men that was having discharges, you know, as well as women. So this law was both for men and women. So there's in Leviticus, it reads about the men, but I'm going to read about the woman because our focus is on the woman with the issue of blood. Amen. So Leviticus 15, verse 25 through 30. So Leviticus 15, 25 through 30. And I'll let you turn there for a moment. Amen. Okay, let's read. So yeah, about bodily discharges. So there was laws about bodily discharges in both men and women. Okay, let's read. And if a woman had an issue of blood many days out of the time of her separation, or if it run beyond the time of her separation, all the days of the issue of her uncleanliness shall be as the days of her separation. She shall be unclean. So she was considered unclean for all the days that she had an issue of blood. So verse 26, every bed whereon she lieth, all the days of her issue shall be unto her as the bed of her separation. And wherever she sit upon shall be unclean as the uncleanness of her separation. Verse 27, and whosoever touches those things shall be unclean, and shall wash his clothes and bathe himself in water and be unclean until the even. Verse 28, but if she be cleansed of her issue, then she shall number to herself 7 days, and after that she shall be clean. Verse 29, and on the 8th day she shall take unto her 2 turtles or 2 young pigeons and bring them unto the priest to the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. Verse 30, and the priest shall offer the one for a sin offering and the other for a burnt offering, and the priest shall make an atonement for her before the Lord for the issue of her uncleanness. Now, just to give you a picture of what she was going through. So she had this issue of blood, and I'm pretty sure, you know how today we can cover up our issues of blood. We have like, you know, pads and things like that we can cover up. But I'm imagining back in those days, they didn't have anything. So if somebody was bleeding, people could see it. And there was a law, so she had to separate herself. So she had to keep herself separate. You know, she couldn't touch anybody. And I can imagine, like, if she was married, if she had children, she wasn't allowed to touch them because they would be considered unclean. Amen? So I'm pretty sure that disrupted her life. She couldn't even go to the temple or the synagogue. She couldn't even go there. She had to keep herself separated for that certain amount of time. So when it says she had to separate herself in the law, for like 7 days, she had to count 7 days. So imagine counting 12 years going through this issue. So she was counting 12 years going through it, so she never stopped, amen? So I imagine she would have to stay in the house. She couldn't go to work. She couldn't go nowhere because everything she touched will be considered unclean. Even if she sat in a chair, it would be considered unclean, right? So even her bed was considered unclean. The chair, anything she touched. So she couldn't go out. Pretty much she had to stay in and separate herself, because if she go out, they would be able to see. And it was against the law at that time for her to be out in a crowd, you know, because I'm pretty sure if she touched somebody, it'll be a crime, and they would, you know, probably want to stone her or something. So I can imagine. So, and I'm pretty sure she wasn't allowed to have like a normal social relationship. You know, I'm pretty sure that disrupted her relationship, because she was bleeding for 12 years. So I couldn't imagine her having a relationship with somebody, you know, a constant flow of blood. So even if she touched someone, like they said, they would be considered unclean. They had to bathe themselves and do other things to become clean, as we saw in the laws. They had to, you know, wash themselves and all that. Amen? So she broke the law by being out in the first place. So when she went out, she was breaking the law. So I can imagine her, you know, going out. You know, first of all, she was being sneaky. Like, she thought, like, she heard about Jesus. So she heard about Jesus. So in the scene when I was talking about before, I'm trying to put it together so you can get a picture of it. So she was hearing about Jesus. Everybody heard about Jesus, because he was going around, you know, healing the sick. He was preaching, you know, all that everywhere. He was going around different cities. So I think she was sneaky. Like, she came through, you know, sneaking through the crowd. I believe she probably crawled through the crowd so they wouldn't see her issue of blood, amen? And she came quietly behind him and touched, just like a little tassel hanging, and she quietly touched the hem of his garment. And I believe she was trying to sneak quietly, but because, you know, Jesus felt virtue coming out of him, he just, whew, turned around like, who touched me? You know, and I believe that Jesus knew who touched him. Amen. He knew who touched him, but I believe he wanted her to come out to confess what happened, give a testimony pretty much. Yeah. So I'm like, yeah, I stopped Jesus right in his track. He turned around and said, who touched me? His disciples was like when we read in the story, he said, who, what are you talking about? Like, who touched you? Like, there's too many people here to know who touched you. I'm pretty sure there was probably thousands and thousands of people around Jesus. But he's like, no. He's like, I've been feeling, you know, and this is my version of the story. He's probably like, yeah, I've been feeling, you know, everybody touching me. But no, something really touched me. You know, it's virtue. Like, people touching me all day long. But then, you know, I'm feeling it. You know, but something triggered me to know that virtue, like power, came out of me. So it got the attention of Jesus. Like, he said, he was walking, probably with the crowd, they're walking. He's like, who touched me, you know, and just immediately turned around. Because I don't know if you felt the power of God on you before, but when virtue comes out of you, you feel it, amen? So when the woman saw that she was not hid, so she knew, I believe that she knew that Jesus saw her, because it says she saw that she was not hid. So she came to Jesus, she fell down, and she started trembling before him and told him what had happened. I believe she was trembling because she knew that she had broke the law. She probably thought she was going to be in trouble, you know, so she's like, let me just tell the story, you know, let me just tell you what happened. So when she touched the hem of his garment, the blood immediately dried up, right? Right? So I'm going to tell you that story, and I'm going to add some more to the story. Amen? And she felt it in her body. So immediately when she touched the hem of Jesus' garment, she immediately felt the issue of blood just dry up in her body immediately. For those that say, you know, sometimes, and it is true, sometimes healing takes, you know, wow, sometimes it comes out in layers, but I've seen and I know from especially the reading the scripture that you can be immediately healed from your issues, amen? So no matter what you're going through, it can be healed immediately. And so that's what God is trying to show you today. Like, he's going to show you how you can get this healed immediately. You don't even need no bun to lay hands on you, amen? So let's keep going. So she had this, so she felt it immediately in her body that she was healed. And remember, she was going through this issue of blood for 12 years. And I want to stress 12 years. 12 years, it becomes a plague to you, amen? Yeah, imagine going through a sickness or anything worse you've been through. Say if you went through COVID, the flu, whatever. Imagine going through that same thing for 12 years. And something put you in the hospital, imagine you going through that for 12 years. You cannot imagine that, right? That will be a thorn in your side, amen? And I know it will mess up your social life. It'll mess up your work life, your relationships, your friendships, because your friends don't want to come around you because you can't touch them because they don't want to be considered unclean. So the law said if she touches something or someone, it will be unclean, like we told you earlier. And I'm doing repetitive so you can get what's going on in here, amen? So she could not touch. So according to the law and all that, she shouldn't have been able to touch Jesus, right? So when she touched Jesus, you know, we had a question. We were talking about this. Me and Elder was talking about this. When she touched Jesus, okay, why wasn't he unclean? You know, after she touched him, and we had a conversation about that, amen? But you can't touch Jesus and make him unclean, amen? There is no sin in him, amen? So anytime you touch Jesus, no matter what you have, it will be clean, amen? So no matter what you go through, it will be clean. So anyway, you can touch Jesus anywhere, and you'll be clean, amen? So there was no sin in him, amen? So whoever touches Jesus become clean. And I just want, as this is what I learned over the years too in ministry. So whatever you touch, the greater power will rule. Amen? So if Jesus is not in you and you go and lay hands on someone that is possessed or, you know, something like that, you just know that the greater power will rule. So that's just the rule of thumb. So you know in ministry, I learned the hard way, you know, but you got to know that the greater power will rule. But we know that Jesus is the greater power, right? So we need Jesus to have that greater power. So no matter if a demon even touch us, nothing will happen, amen? We'll make that demon clean, amen, if they touch us. So we got to know that, amen? So no matter how filthy or unclean we are, if we touch Jesus by faith, we will be made whole, amen? So you have to touch him by faith. We will be healed, delivered, and set free. And when she told Jesus a story, he said, thy faith has made you whole, go in peace. So we know when Jesus healed, delivered, and set us free, he sends us in peace, amen? There is no chaos. There is no chaos after that. So she sent, going back to the lady with issue of blood, so let's tell you her story. So she spent her whole life savings. She spent her income on doctors. And I can imagine her life was spent like making doctor's appointments after doctor appointments. When you're sick, you seek the doctors to, you know, give you medicine to heal you. And I believe probably the doctor at that time probably, you know, made some medicine and probably, you know, stirred something up, made some herbs and stuff and gave it to her. But it only grew worse. So as she went to different doctors everywhere, running around, be like, oh, yeah, they can heal this. But she grew worse. The Bible says she grew worse. So imagine the doctor giving you pills and all that, and your condition is growing worse. Amen? So you would be devastated, right, at that point. So she spent all that she had. I believe she spent her money, her dreams, her visions, stuff that she wanted to, you know, do in life. You know, she could not do those things because she was busy, you know, trying to find a way to get herself healed so she can go out in the public and do things, right? And yes, and why? Because she put her trust in man. She put her trust in man and tried to get healed her way. How many of us try to do things our way? So we need healing in our body. We need something. But we're like, oh, I'm going to go do this. I'm going to do this myself so I can do this my way, right? How many of us know that our way does not work? Amen? So you cannot do things your way. You have to amen. You have to put your trust in Jesus. Amen? She was trying to do things her way. Well, I'm going to go to this doctor. I'm going to go to Dr. Watermelon. I'm going to go to Dr. Lemon. I'm going to go here to this doctor. Ooh, I heard about the witch doctor that, you know, is healing people. I'm going to run over there, give him some money, you know, because he's asking for money. Oh, yeah, he said he could heal me. So I'm pretty sure she was running around going to these different people. You know, when you hear, it's hearsay. you know, when you hear about something, you want to run over there. Because I remember in ministry, when you hear about like a prophet of God or a powerful man or woman of God, you want to run over there and like, oh, I want to get my healing. You know, you want to run to the power of God. And you're like, okay, you want to run. So I can imagine her, you know, trying to run and get healed. Amen. So, yeah, she was seeking doctors. She was, I'm pretty sure she was doing everything, trying to make money to go. And, you know, but she spent everything she had. Amen. So don't try to do things your way, amen, because it will not work. Without God, we know that things will get worse, and we know that you can do nothing without God, amen? So Jesus went about, and so the beginning, this is what he was doing before the lady with issue of blood, right? So Jesus went about in all the cities teaching. He was teaching in the synagogues. He was preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing. He was healing every sickness and every disease among the people. So remember that. So he was going around healing every sickness, every disease. So imagine, of course, if you hear in our time, if you hear about somebody healing sickness, diseases, you're gonna go run to them, right? Especially if you have an issue of blood for 12 years. So he was healing everybody. So everybody was running to Jesus at that time. They were running, they were crowded around him, they were touching him, and as they were touching him, they were being healed. Because they believed it, you know, amen. So as they crowded around him, they kept touching him because they wanted to be healed, all of them. So he says he healed all of them. And I didn't see that when I was studying the scriptures and going through it. I did not see that. It just stood out to me. It's like Jesus healed all of them. So we got to put that in the back of our mind. Like Jesus don't just heal some, he heals all, amen. And even though he was even healing the people that were vexed with like demonic spirits, they had demonic spirits on them. You know, he was even, they were considered unclean. They were being healed as well. So he was going about doing miracles and stuff, amen? So the Bible says, and I'm gonna tell you how to get healed, amen? How to be healed, delivered, and set free. First of all, the Bible says first, she heard. She heard about Jesus healing people. So imagine you can't have Jesus walking around, you know, he's going, a crowd of people crowded around him, and she didn't hear that. You know she heard it because everybody's around town talking about it. So in our day, you know, when something happens, everybody's talking about it, amen? So especially when, you know, people fall in ministry, whatever, you hear people talking about it everywhere. So we know that when Jesus was healing people, they were talking about it. So first, you need to hear. You need to hear. So she heard about Jesus healing people. And then after you hear, you have to hear about Jesus. You have to hear the word of God. Amen? Then she believed. So after she heard, she believed what she heard. So as Jesus was going around healing people, she's like, oh, yeah, he's healing people. Like, she's like, oh, I got to see this. Like, I believe it. Like, I believe my issue, you know, can get healed. I've been like this for 12 years. I'm really desperate. Like, I've been to every doctor, so I'm desperate. Like, there's desperation in me, amen? I believe this thing, so I'm going to get desperate. And I'm going to go out, and I'm going to get healed, amen? So she believed. So she believed within herself. The Bible says she's believed within herself. So you have to hear and then you have to believe it within yourself that Jesus is a healer. Amen. Believe it within yourself. And then she touched his garment. Amen. So she believed that if she could just touch the hem of his garment, that she will be made whole. Amen. So she touched the hem of his garment, believing. First she heard, then she believed. She believed that if I just touch the hem of his garment, I will be made whole. Amen. I'll be healed from this issue of blood. I will be healed from this 12-year plague. Amen. So she believed it. Hallelujah. And then immediately, because she believed, she was instantly healed. Amen. It says she was healed that very hour, and that be instantly. Amen. And she had to disobey the law, and she snuck out. Like I said, she snuck out. I believe she crawled through the crowd to just try to reach the hem of his garment. I don't know about you, but if you're desperate, you know, you really need something, you're desperate, you will break the law. You will go through whatever you need to do to get that healing if you believe that you're going to be healed through it, right? And so that's what she believed, amen? She crawled through the crowd. And as soon as she touched the hem of his garment, it says she was made whole instantly, amen? So as soon as she touched him, immediately. And so as she touched him, Jesus turned around. He turned around and was like, touched me. He turned around. So in order to get God's attention, and I'm going to talk about faith in a minute. We're going to talk about this. In order to get his attention, you need to have faith. And I'm going to go over what faith is so you can know how to be healed, delivered, and set free. Amen? Amen. So Jesus turned around, and I believe, like I said, I knew he knew who touched him. But he wanted her to confess. Amen? So I believe she wanted to openly confess on her own, you know, pretty much to give a testimony about what had happened to her. It was not the fact that she touched his garment. I believe she could have touched anywhere on his garment. And even Jesus told her, it's your faith. Your faith made you whole. So she could have touched anywhere. You know, she could have touched his head. She could have touched his anywhere, anywhere. It was not the garments that she touched. And also there was a significance on the garment as well. So if you ever want to go through that, it's in the book of Numbers 15. We're not going to go through that today. But there's significance in what he was wearing, amen, in the garments that he was wearing. Amen. So, yeah, I was going to go through that, but it's in Numbers 15 if you want to read that on your own. We might just, you know what, let's just go read it. The significance of his garment, amen. Yes, and then Jesus told her it wasn't the garment that made you whole. Jesus said it was your faith that made you whole, and not in touching this garment. So let me talk about the garment. Okay, the garment is in Numbers 15. So go to Numbers 15, and we're going to read verse 39 through 41. And it says, it shall be unto you for a fringe, that ye may look upon it and remember all the commandments of the Lord and do them. And that ye seek not after your own heart and your own eyes, after which ye used to go a whoring, that ye may remember and do all my commandments and be holy unto your God. I am the Lord your God, which brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. I am the Lord your God. Amen. So the tassels in the corners was just a reminder of what we just read, amen? A reminder of obedience, a reminder of that the Lord is your God, amen? It's just a reminder to keep God's commandments, amen? It's just a reminder, you know how they had the tassels in that day? We have Holy Spirit in our day, amen? As a reminder that I am your Lord, I am your God, amen? We have Holy Spirit today, hallelujah, that lives inside of us, amen? And we're going to talk about that. If you don't have the Holy Spirit, we're going to talk about that as well. How do you receive him? Amen. So imagine bleeding for 12 years. Let's go back to the 12 years. I can't get over this issue of blood for 12 years. And I believe that her condition dominated her whole life. It took over her life. Like this, if you're bleeding for 12 years straight, I mean, some of us, you know, go through cycles or discharge, whatever, for a few days, and we're like, oh, I'm dying, you know. And imagine her going through it for 12 years. Yeah, and I'm pretty sure it was like she was probably depressed. She was probably just going through stuff. You know, she was overwhelmed in her life. You know, when we talked about the children and the husband, if she had one, she couldn't even engage with them. She couldn't touch them. They'll be considered unclean. She kept going to doctor after doctor, doctor this, doctor that, doctor watermelon. She still couldn't get healed of the issue of her blood. Amen. But nobody could heal her. Nobody could heal her. And you know what? What I thought about this as I was praying yesterday, she didn't even have an identity. This issue of blood took away her identity. If you read the scriptures, she don't even have a name. It just talks about the woman with the issue of blood. I'm like, what's her name? You know, it took your issues can take away your identity. So this plague, this disease, this sickness took away her identity. She didn't even have a name. I don't know if you ever thought about that, but there was no name mentioned. So the plague stole her identity. The focus was on her issue of blood. So in the scriptures, the focus was on the issue of blood and not as her as a person. So there was the focus. Although this woman with the issue of blood, so her as a person, it was her personality was depleted because she had this issue. It took over. We know her as the woman with the issue of blood and not by her name. Amen. This would make you desperate. She was desperate to get healed. She's like, I don't even have a name. They're just calling me the woman with issue of blood. Like, that's all they're calling me. Like, they're calling me names. Like, I can't even go outside, you know, without being called a name. I don't even have my own identity. I don't even know who I am anymore. So I'm hearing about Jesus, and I'm desperate. Amen? Hear the word desperate. Some of us are fighting our flesh today. Will you be desperate for the Lord today? We will be desperate. Are you desperate to touch the hem of Jesus' garment today so you can be healed of your own flesh issues? Amen? Of your own issue. It don't even have to be flesh. It could just be issues. It could be character flaws. It could be anything. Okay, so let's go over some points. So in order to be healed, delivered, and set free, you have to hear the word of God. Then you have to believe it, which I said earlier, right? So you got to hear it. Hear the word of God. You have to believe that word within yourself. Amen? The Bible says she heard Jesus and she believed within herself if she could touch the hem of his garment, she will be completely made whole. Amen? She'll be healed of her plague. Now, how do you get faith? Because you need faith in order to, she believed, so you, that's faith. So faith, you have to. How do you get faith? She said, prophetess, how do you get faith? Let's read Romans 10, 17. So Romans 10, 17 says, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So if you want to know how to get faith to be touched, for Jesus to be able to touch you, that you believe, you have to have faith. Believe that he will do it for you. Amen? So this is how you get faith. If you don't know how to get faith, you need to read Romans 10, 17. So faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Amen? So now what is faith? Let's read Hebrews 11, 1. Hebrews 11, 1. Now it reads, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. The woman hoped for healing, and she believed it, although she didn't see it. Amen? And as she moved on what she hoped and believed, she was healed. Amen? So faith makes this hope for faith makes us hope for as real if it already happened. So faith makes you hope for what has not happened yet, what you have not seen. Amen? So she believed that she will be healed. She didn't see her healing yet. She didn't see it. But she, by faith, she believed it, amen, that it was already done. So you have to believe whatever you're believing for today, you have to believe that it is already done. Walk by faith and not by sight. It brings the future within the present and makes the invisible seen, amen? So faith is having confidence, belief, and trust in the loyalty of God, amen? So you have to have confidence, belief, and trust in the loyalty of God, that God will do it. Amen? So faith needs some kind of promise, some kind of promise of God as a foundation. So our foundation pretty much is the word of God. So you have to have a foundation. So, and I'm going to give you an example. Say if you're sick and you need healing, right? You, in order to have faith, you need some kind of promise. So how would you know you can get healed, right? So you got to go through the word of God. If you go through the word of God and you read a scripture, you say, it says, by my stripes I am healed. So you take that scripture. You take that scripture as a foundation. And you tell the Lord, you say, this is the foundation. I have faith. I believe in your word that by my stripes I will be healed. So you take that scripture. You stand on it because that's your faith. And that's your foundation of your faith, what you believe in, right? Because you have to have a foundation on what you believe in order to believe it, right? So by his stripes you are healed. You take that scripture. You run with it. And Lord said, remind him of his word. Amen. So God moves by faith, not by your titles. You can be bishop such and such, apostle such and such, minister such and such. God is not moved by your titles. You can have all the titles in the world, but if you have no faith, you are not going to get the attention of God. You are not going to move God. Amen? So if you imagine her not having faith, she just in the crowd like, oh, okay, I heard. And Jesus in there, he's going to keep walking in the crowd. Her faith is not going to touch him. You know, if she don't believe that, if she don't believe, oh, I'm just walk with this crowd and just see what he gonna do. I'm just gonna be a spectator. I'm just gonna watch. She's not gonna be healed because she's not believing in nothing. She don't have no foundation of what, no focus on what she, her attention is on, amen? And it don't matter how rich, how poor you are, amen, it does not matter. If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, the Bible says you can move mountains, amen? Amen. So faith will cause Jesus to turn around in another direction on your behalf. So he can be praying like he was praying for Jairus' daughter. You know, he was going to pray for her, and imagine this lady touching him. He just turned around like, oh, wait, no. She's getting his attention, right? So he could be, you know, headed towards somewhere else. But because your faith is strong, it'll turn him in another direction and focus on you. Amen? Yeah, amen. So he moved through the crowd looking for the person that touched him. Was the lady with issue of blood. Amen? So faith makes the impossible possible. Amen? It makes the impossible possible. If you think something is impossible, I'm here to tell you today that there is nothing impossible with God. Amen? The just shall live by faith. And let's go to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. Amen? So it says, and you have to have faith. You have to have that foundation. The foundation is the word of God. Amen? You have to be in your word. You have to read and study your word to show yourself approved. Amen? And you also have to know the word to have faith in order to get healed, get delivered, be set free. Amen? In the name of Jesus. And the Bible says, for without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Amen? If you want to please God, you need to have faith. That's according to the word of God. That is not friend. That is not me. That is the word of God. You have to have faith, and you have to believe that he is, and know that he is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. Amen? And diligently means, in the Webster's Dictionary, to be steady, to be earnest and energetic in your effort. Amen? So you got to seek him in a desperate situation. Amen? You got to seek him with desperation. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. And let's go to verse 7. Amen? Verse 7, it says, by faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. So even Noah, amen, by faith, being warned of God. So that was his foundation. God warned him, amen, and he walked by faith and he was saved, amen. So if you continue to read down, it talks about Abraham, it talks about Sarah, and so on, amen? They heard God, and they believed it, and they acted on it, amen? You have to have faith and believe that God will heal you if you can just touch him, amen? So now you got to touch him by faith. You cannot see him, amen? But you got to touch him by faith, amen? So faith has to have an object. So there has to be an object. The object is the focus point. The object or focus point is Jesus. So that's your focal point, will be Jesus. Amen? And the reward is being made whole and going in peace. Amen? So your focus is on Jesus. First you hear about Jesus by the word of God. While I'm speaking, you're hearing the word. You have to believe the word of God. Amen? You have to focus on the object, and the object is Jesus. Amen? And then once he make you whole, you go in peace. He's not going to make you whole and then you're sick the next day. Are you sick that very hour? No, he's going to send you in peace. Amen? According to Romans chapter 5, verse 1, it says, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So if you do not have peace today, we need to go through these scriptures and we need to have peace. Amen? Amen. So, hallelujah. So we are healed, delivered, and set free. Amen. So you have to believe by faith that you are healed, delivered, and set free from any issue. I don't care what it is. It could be any sickness. It could be any disease. It could be gossiping. It could be backbiting. It can be envy. It could be jealousy. It could be pride. It could be character flaws. No matter what you're going through, it could be financial. It could be job loss. It could be anything. Like our brother testified earlier, losing income. Amen. So it could be anything. That can be your issue, amen? Any issue. We were talking about the woman with issue of blood, but we bring it to our day. It's any issue. She touched the hem of Jesus' garment, amen? Hallelujah. She did not touch him physically. She touched him by faith, amen? So you have to hear the word of God. You have to believe it and walk in faith, hallelujah, because you have to have an action behind what you believe in, amen? So if you don't have no action behind what you believe, hallelujah, nothing's going to happen for you, amen? So you have to put action to it. So if she did not, she could have believed in her house, oh, I believe Jesus is going to heal me because I heard about it. She will still be sitting there 24 years later with the issue of blood, but she acted on what she believed. So today, if you have an issue, you need to act on what you believe. Amen. You heard the word of God, by his stripes you are healed. So you need to act on that word of God today. So if God tells you to come forth, you need to come forth and put yourself in motion, hallelujah, to align yourself with what God wants to do for you. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So you need to act on what you believe. Hallelujah. When she heard of Jesus, she came behind him. Amen. She thought she would be sneaky. Like I was telling you, and came behind him and touched his garment. Some of us are sneaky. We try to get in the back door, but Jesus said, I am the only way. Amen. So you cannot get in the back door on anything. Amen. And she pressed her way. How many of you need to press your way to get to Jesus today? You need to press in. You need to be desperate for God. Hallelujah. We have faith. We need to have faith in our Christian walk. The Bible says in Hebrews 11:6, again, without faith it's impossible to please God. I want to get that in your mind. You need faith, 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 faith. Faith come by hearing, hearing by the word of God. So you need to read your word, hallelujah. You need to get in the scriptures, and you need to know that God is a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. So you need to seek God with your all, hallelujah. Faith touches Jesus, amen. Faith touches Jesus. So once you hear the word of God, you heard about Jesus as a healer, right? Then you get faith, then you must focus on Jesus. And when you come to Jesus, you must believe that you have heard about what you heard about him and believe that he is a rewarder, right? So then faith requires movement, like I said, on your part. You need to move, hallelujah. So now you have faith, right? Because you've heard the word, you believe it, and now you walk towards it, which is to seek him for any issues that you have. Faith touches Jesus, causing him to stop and say, who touched me? How many of us today want Jesus to stop and turn around and focus on you and be like, who touched me, right? That's what I want. I want Jesus to turn around and say, who touched me? Your faith has made you whole. Go in peace, sister, right? Go in peace, daughter. Amen. When you have faith in Jesus, that will heal. When you have faith in Jesus, hallelujah, he will heal, deliver, and set you free, amen? There is always peace that follows it, so know when God delivers you, sets you free, it's always peace. There's always peace behind it, amen? He said, go in peace. He's not, don't go in chaos. Don't go and gossip about your brothers and sisters after God has healed you, right? Don't do that. Ask yourself this question. Are you running from God, trying to do things your way today? Are you dealing with unforgiveness in your heart? Do you have an out with your brother or sister? Are you dealing with something in your hearts today? Are you dealing with hurt, like church hurt? Are you dealing with hurt from your families? Are you desperate for Jesus today? Ask yourself, are you desperate for Jesus today? That is a word. You got to be desperate, diligently seek him. Are you desperate to get healed, delivered, and set free? Healing and deliverance is in the room today. Hallelujah. Do you need a touch from Jesus today? Amen. Do you need a touch from Jesus? What is your issue today? Think about this. What is your issue today? You have to acknowledge that you have an issue, number one. If you don't acknowledge that you have an issue, like you have character flaws, you have sickness, you have problems, you have mental illness, whatever you have, if you do not acknowledge it, you need to acknowledge it first, that you have this problem, because you need to know, you need to focus on the object to heal that problem. You say, I have no problem, then you have nothing to be healed, right? So you cannot be in denial of any issues you may have. You may think you're the sign and wonder of the world. Oh, I have gifts. I have calling. I can play the drums so good. You know, I could do that, so I don't have no problems. I don't have no issues. And that's where we go in error, thinking that we have arrived. But I'm here to tell us nobody has arrived today. Amen? So even I have issues, amen? So I am not in denial. And even if we're having issues with our families, I even had issues with my family, the enemy attacking me today, even yesterday, day before, just because to bring the word, amen? So I was like, the devil is a liar. So even if you're having family issues, you're having issues that you need income, amen? You, any kind of issues, amen? You have to be desperate for God. First, you heard the word, amen? And also, if you're fighting depression, if you can, you can play the music if you can, hallelujah. Are you fighting depression today, hallelujah? Are you fighting oppression today? Are you fighting loneliness today, anger today, character flaws? Are you suffering from domestic violence? We have to speak that out as well. Mental illness, suicidal ideation, bad thoughts, bad dreams, financial issues, marital problems, church hurt, people hurt. How long have you been bleeding out? That's the question I want to ask you today. How long will you allow yourself to bleed out? Today, Jesus is saying, you heard the word. Now he's saying you need to believe it, right? So you heard the word today. So now he's saying, believe my word. Hallelujah. Believe it by faith. And you need to walk towards it, towards your healing today. It don't even have to be healing. It could be anything you need. Make your request known to God today, amen? In the name of Jesus, today is your day. Today is your day of deliverance. Today is your day to be set free, hallelujah. Today is your day, hallelujah. So we thank you, Jesus, hallelujah. No longer will your issues hold you back. No longer will you be bound. We command the bound to be set free today. In the mighty name of Jesus, be healed. We declare and decree that you are healed. You are delivered, and you are set free. No matter what issues you are going through, you need to birth out your purpose. Hallelujah. And today, God wants to birth out your purpose. Amen. In the name of Jesus, birth your purpose. Amen. For those that you've been held back, you have been held back. You have a calling. You have things to do in God. Each and every person in this room have callings. We have gifts. There is no big eyes, and there's no little use. So we all have a calling. Amen. So we need to come forth in our calling today. Do not let people oppress your gifts. Amen. I allow people to oppress my gifts for so many years, but the Lord said, no, I need you to be desperate for me. I walked towards Jesus. I heard the word. I had faith, and I started to get desperate for God. I started to seek in God with my all. Amen. So today, you need to be desperate for God. Just so you know, there is purpose in your pain. There is always purpose in your pain. Amen. You are not going through that thing in vain. Amen. You are going through to come out as pure gold. Amen. So you know when someone carries the anointing, that they have been through some stuff. So if you haven't been through anything, woo, you haven't arrived. So you need to seek God. You have to go through some stuff. Yep. When you go through stuff, you go through stuff. The greater the calling, the greater things that will happen to you. Much is given, much is required. What required? Jesus is saying today, will you press your way to touch me? Amen. And it's not the person that's speaking. You're touching Jesus. Amen. You have to believe that you're touching him by faith. And Jesus is asking, will you press your way? Will you press your way to touch me? God wants to restore you today. Amen. He wants to restore you. Amen. God wants to heal you. Amen. He will heal you as you're going through. But you do have a gift. You have a calling no matter what. Amen. So you need to come forth in what God has called you to do. We come against fear right now in the name of Jesus. We cancel that out of the atmosphere. And I used to, and just to give you a testimony, I used to, God was like, oh, you're going to be up there with these women. He was showing me a bunch of women, powerful women of God. They have big voices like thunder. And here's my little squeaky voice. I'm like, oh, Lord, I can't do it. I can't do it. Look, my voice is so little. So you cannot compare yourself to anyone else. You have your own voice, amen? You have your own calling, amen? So you cannot be like sister such and such. Our voices may reach certain people. Their voices may reach certain people. So we have to know who we are and walk in who we're called to be, amen? Jesus said in John 14, I am the way, I am the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Will you come to Jesus today? If you don't know the Lord and Savior, if you don't know the Lord as your personal Savior and want to know him, please come to the altar. A word from the Lord can drive out any sickness, any disease, any issue, no matter what you're going through. All you need is hear the word and a touch from God, amen? And believe that word, amen? In the name of Jesus. And people, just know that people will cause you to push yourself back, to hide back, and to drown in your issues, amen? You have to press your way through. Just like the Bible says, the woman pressed her way through the crowd, amen? Even though the law told her not to, she pressed her way through. So will you press your way through, hallelujah, to reach Jesus today? Amen. Are you determined to be made whole from your condition today? If you're going through something and you need a touch from God, come to the altar today. Come to the altar today. If you are sick in your body, you need healing, Jesus is saying, come to the altar today. If you need to be delivered, to be set free from anything physical, hallelujah. A lot of people are going through sickness right now. They have COVID. They have all kind of stuff going on right now, but the devil is a liar. There is healing in the room, amen? Anybody going through physical abuse, verbal abuse, mistreatment, come to the altar, amen? Believe God today. Will your faith touch Jesus? That's the question we have for you. Will your faith touch Jesus? Will you be desperate for the Lord today? Come down and get what you need from God, amen? God is the healer. He is the deliverer. There is healing power in the name of Jesus today, amen? You want to receive the Holy Spirit? You have not spoken in other tongues? Come down to the altar, amen? Seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything else will be added to you. And what is that everything? Everything you need is at the altar today. Anything you need is in the room today, amen? A touch from Jesus is all you need. Just a touch from Jesus. Will your faith touch Jesus today? Amen? God wants to restore your identity today. Will you let him? Instead of being identified by your problem, God wants to restore your identity today. Will you allow God to do it? And it's not the vessel that's speaking. It's your faith and to believe that Jesus will do it. Amen? I'm just an empty vessel that God will use, amen, for his glory. I'm going to touch my faith with your faith, amen, that God will do what he wants to do today. So if you're in the room, you just want a touch from God, amen, don't look at the person, look at Jesus. You're coming for Jesus. It's not about me, hallelujah. I am not here. All you should see right now is Jesus, amen. Jesus is in the room. If you need a job today, Jesus has it in the room today in the name of Jesus. You need financial breakthrough, it's in the room today. Hallelujah. If you need healing from your sickness, any disease, God said it's in the room. It's in the room. He says, I am here. Hallelujah. He says, I am here. Whatever you need, hallelujah. You can never look at the vessel because you don't know. Someone can look like nothing, but that person may be carrying everything that you need, amen? So you have to seek God, amen? In the name of Jesus, we thank you. We thank you, Jesus. We bless your name for today, Lord God. Father, we just ask that you have your way, Lord, as each and every person come to the altar, Lord God, today. We just ask that you have your way and meet all of their needs in the name of Jesus. Father, we bless you, Lord. Holy Spirit, we just ask that you will take over right now, Lord, and give your people what they need, Lord God, as they believe you by faith, touching you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. They're going to touch your hymn today, and they're going to be made whole, Lord, according to your word. We thank you and we pray.
Position of prayer today for those who are getting prayed for in Jesus' name. One word at a time. One word at a time. One word at a time. That's how a baby starts. One word at a time. And you got filled today with the evidence thereof. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, that's hers now. Don't be stealing that, brother. That's hers. Gonna have to repent there. I'm teasing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What a message of God. The Holy Spirit is here today to heal, set free, and thank God for what he did for you today. Because we knew that you got filled. You just keep on praising God, and you keep on saying that one word over, and then you get another word, and then another. Pretty soon you're going to be out speaking Pastor Paulette in tongues. Hallelujah. And that's saying a lot. Hallelujah. And Isaac, your day's coming. It's coming, okay? It's coming. You know, you're getting tutelage from just about every different facet here. And, you know, all I could tell you is the same thing I already told you. Contend for it. Thank God with all of your heart. Don't worry about what anyone thinks about what you're saying. Just praise God. When you throw your hands up in the air, that's an act of surrender. It's like I'm a cop and I'll say, stick them up. You're going to put your hands up in the air. That's what you're doing to God. But then you're going to thank him for your salvation. And as you continue to thank him, then the word will start coming out. Something. It'll come out. Hallelujah. Wow. Now that we're warmed up, can we start our service? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to thank everyone for coming out. And, you know, I've come here now so I could get your money. Hallelujah. I mean, if the Lord's blessed you today, say amen. I said, if the Lord blessed you today, say amen. 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 I was blessed. Hallelujah. And it's funny, prophet's friend, as we read the Bible, just yesterday morning, right? And I don't have my pen with me here, but you see where I underlined on up here? See that? Didn't you talk about that today? Yeah, you sure did. Sure did. About the fringe of the border, the blue fringe. That's what it was. That's what's on the tassel. That's why there's blue in there. It's to remind us of the commandments of the Lord. Okay? Hallelujah. The things, Don, that was said to you today from Prophetess Friend was said last night. She wasn't here. As I remember, Apostle said, you're overanalyzing. Analysis paralysis. Hallelujah. We had a great shut-in service last night into this morning. And I had dreams about it. You know, all I can say is God's moving. You know, I find myself and my wife, Gwen, who's also a prophetess, that she'll say the same thing. She'll say something, give a word, and then, you know, an hour, 2 hours later, I might be watching Perry Stone or Jonathan Cahn or something. They'll say the exact same thing, verbatim, word for word, okay? Andrew, I hope you got something out of this today. You know, I am still jealous of your biblical name, though, okay? Hallelujah. I'm teasing about that. Praise the Lord. In the book of Malachi, that is the last chapter of the Old Testament. And I'm just going to repeat it. We all know it by heart, for the most part. But in chapter 3, verses 10, 11, it reads, "Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse," that's where we're at today, "that there may be meat in your house," it says mine house, "and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord of hosts." In other words, you're going to test God. "If I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, and there shall not be room enough to receive it. And I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, and he shall not destroy the fruits of your ground, neither shall your vine cast her fruit before time in the field, saith the Lord of hosts." Now, for those of you who have cash, feel free to bring it up. If you have the Cash app, then I recommend that. And that is the money sign, Triumphant, then capital MININTL. That's for Triumphant Ministries International. So feel free to go ahead and post up $1 million that I know that one of you has out here. God's going to give it to you. Hallelujah. So that's a joke, by the way, Rochelle. That was just a joke. Praise the Lord. Brother Darren, good to see you. God bless you. Okay, Brother John, God bless you. Hallelujah. So we want to give everyone a chance to give. If you don't have that, then you can go on to Zelle, okay? We'll take a check, and you can give it to Pastor Paulette. Hallelujah. Make it out to Triumphant Ministries International. That's spelled P-A-U-L-A-G-R-E-E-N. No, it's not. It's Triumphant Ministries International. That's a joke, Pastor Paulette. Hallelujah. I have to keep people engaged. Well, I'm digging. See? I got a few courtesy laughs there. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Has everyone had a chance and an opportunity to give? Amen? Hallelujah. All right, so everyone stretch your hands forth to the bowl as Isaac lifts it up to God. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we give you thanks. We give you honor. We give you praise. We thank you for these gifts. We thank you for the givers, Lord God. We pray that you multiply it, bring forth 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold in Jesus' name. And we all said, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, it's been a good time in the Lord here today. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I thank each and every one of you for coming out here. And I would be remiss if I did not pray the Aaronic prayer over you. Not the ironic prayer, Don. The Aaronic prayer. Hallelujah. Everyone turn to Numbers chapter 6. Numbers chapter 6. And if you're Star Trek fans, you'll remember this is what Spock said, right? What would he do with his hand? Live, Don, you're stealing my thunder. Live long and prosper. Now, for those of you who don't know that Leonard Nimoy in Star Trek, Spock, he was Jewish. And he's the one who came up with this. So this is what Jesus did as he was departing up in the clouds, as he was blessing the disciples, as he was being lifted up in the clouds, the 11 disciples, right? Because remember what happened to the 12th guy, right? So, as he went up, he said this in Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 through 26. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. You are dismissed in Jesus' name. Say hi to someone on your way out.